And now, ladies and gentlemen, the Hungry Eye is very proud to announce the next President of the United States, Mort.
Thank you. We're making records here. I hope this won't. I just want to explain what all these mics for. I don't want to do an imitation of the president, and I don't have Jim Haggerty here. So, I have Sherman Adams though in the back. At any rate, the president and Sherman Adams and Arthur Godfrey and Tony Marvin. It kind of works out that way. Anyway, we're making records here, and this cable goes back. And the recording engineer is Herbert Philbrick, whom you may know. Now, I want to, before I dig the brick wall, I'm still a bohemian. I don't want any of you to think that I sold out. And the generation is now in style, isn't it? The beat generation. Anyway, I wanted to mention here, before we go any farther, that President Eisenhower is going to run for a third term, and I thought that should take precedence over homecoming speeches and all things like that. And he made a speech last night, which got a 7 on NBC, it says, right? And Zorro got an 18. Well, anyway, so President Eisenhower is going to run for a third term, and in the meantime, or at least he said he would, Vice President Nixon has his hand on the switch. And I was in the East when the president got sick, and Vice President Nixon moved in and started appearing in all these magazines, and he sort of came of age here at the end of the year. And he's right, and he got his glasses. He got those new glasses and all, and with wrought iron frames, right? Remember those? So anyway, President Eisenhower was depending on Vice President Nixon to keep his hand on the throttle, and he was on all these magazines like Time and Newsweek and Life, and almost every magazine with the exception of True, which has a hidden significance, which I'm not... Anyway, so... Anyway, neutral colors. So at any rate, the Vice President Nixon, as you know, was supposed to go to the NATO meeting. He's in charge of calling eggheads back. That's what it says here. And he's going to woo them for the administration. So several eggheads have been called back, including Dr. Oppenheimer, who was granted amnesty this week. And he is taking a quick course in German so he may join the others defending our country, right? So I kind of... Anyway, thank you. Thank you. So anyway... I might add, you know, that I've been working with nothing but jazz all year, and I haven't been working with any folk singers. I've been away from the womb, you know, and I gotta tell you. So I'm working with all the jazz people, and I saw one folk singer in New York, but then it was like a vacation, you know, it didn't mean anything. And it was a guy at the Waldorf who was wearing a velvet shirt, just kind of skin tight, open to the navel. You know, one of those fellas, and he didn't have one. That's what I wanted to tell you about. So, at any rate, right, which is either a show business gimmick, of course, or the ultimate rejection of mother, which, right, no, right. Anyway. So, again, right, I know, getting into psychology here, I want to forget my political conscience, right, so, we were on the road, and when we went out with Dave, both of us went out with Dave Brubeck, and who is, of course, an alumnus of this area, and we, did a tour through the Ivy League, brainwashing students, and we went up through some great schools, a lot of schools like St. Lawrence and Cornell, a lot of those, and a few outside schools that aren't Ivy League, but these students are allowed to wear the clothing anyway, which is a step ahead. Right? I know. I think better understanding is coming out of all of this. So we wound up the tour in Portland, Maine on Saturday night, and those of you who haven't been in Maine, you know, you hear all the jokes about Philadelphia? Well, we were in Maine on Saturday night, which is kind of depressing, and we're supposed to work, and there were a lot of rumors that Brubeck didn't want to work because it was Mozart's birthday. There was one of those folklore things going, right? And he wants to, right? He wants... said, well, he wants to spend it with his kids. We all have a thing, you know, and so that's what he... So I went into town with this other fellow in the unit who's a bachelor. We went into town, and we went to see what was shaking in Portland, Maine at night. So, right, and it's kind of a fantasy we're living in. So we went... to this cab driver, and I don't want you to think we're like that, you know, but you must remember what men are like in war. It's that kind of a show tonight. So we went to this cab driver, and we said to him, where's the action? This kind of masculine sort of... So he took us to this place where they fish illegally. See, you know, that's... Thank you. You were right. So I really have had a lot of success with the message since I saw some of you, and appeared in a series of magazines, and appeared in The Reporter, which is always a thrill, and I appear, of course, I'm not saying that you should read it. I don't read it. I mean, it was at this guy's house. I didn't know anything about it. And in fact, I don't even know him, if you want to know. But Senator. Anyway, it's great. And The Reporter carried an article on me this week called The Iconoclast in the Nightclub. I-K-E-O-R. Anyway, so it said The Iconic, and that meant a lot. And then had a lot of luck with The New Yorker since I was here, which is kind of a college girl's Bible. And when... I got great acceptance with college girls, if that's desirable. And I had, on account of The New Yorker, and they had this article in the Talk of the Town section, which quoted me as saying, I have a Christ-like vision of myself. And actually, that's where the article started, and then it kind of built, you know, from there up to the climatic, right? So, oh, I said it. I'm not going to cop out. I really said it. Because I think if you're going to identify with somebody, you really ought to come on, you know, go like, go, right? That's right, right? All right. So, at any rate, I wanted this one point about the eggheads I wanted to make is that one of the eggheads who testified at the Senate committee is General Curtis LeMay, and he's an egghead. And as you know, the Russians have developed a B-52 like ours and the B-47, and they copied the organizational chart of the Strategic Air Command, and they've even developed a guy who looks like General LeMay, you know, this kind of guy. But LeMay is going to Argentina tomorrow, and he's flying from Strategic Air Command headquarters in the new B-58, which is modified. That's the plane they call the Hustler, Convair. And he's going to Argentina, he hopes, in a record time. And he's going from Omaha, which is the headquarters of SAC. And Omaha is kind of the nerve center of America, according to LeMay. A lot of people feel that New York is rather active, and Chicago has a lot of traffic. But he's depending... You see, he's depending on the St. Lawrence Seaway, because when that comes through... So when that comes through, you'll be able to take a boat to Europe from Omaha. Do you know that? Be able to go down to the river there past the train station in Omaha with a flashlight at night and meet refugees from Israel. Sure. Listen. Good things are happening if only you'll write. So let's... they wouldn't be in Washington if they didn't know what they were doing, and they're not there. All right? Good. So... Anyway, so LeMay said, I'm going to Argentina in 10 hours. That's his plan. And he's taking this plane there in an effort to shake up the Russians. And no, you don't think so? Skepticism, eh? Well, I think it will. I think it'll terrify them. Provided they look down and see his plane go by, there'll be a feeling of alarm. I know. So, thank you, friends and neighbors. So, now I wanted to say a few words. Before we, I have a lot of hostility tonight to bring out here. I want to say something about the president's press conference, and this being a primitive form of theater here, I really can. My attempts to entertain you and take your mind off the fact that there was an explosion in the shaft and we're trapped. All right, so. Well, boy, cliches? I know, I have a lot of cliches. On the way up here this afternoon, we ran into a great cliche at the Los Angeles International Airport. That's where I was, in Los Angeles. And as you know, I was in Los Angeles to do missionary work among the heathen, I might add. And I had Los Angeles, as you know, has a notable lack of rapport with this city, or you might put it the other way. It depends. But at any rate, it's converse, and it really reached the point where there's no one to talk to. I couldn't communicate with people. And as you know, during civilian defense tests, neither city will warn the other of approaching aircraft. So, it's a great town, though. A lot of heart. Anyway, that's where we were. We were at this airport, and we're having a lot of problems coming in, and on account of the weather. And it's raining in Los Angeles there. It's kind of a blight on the area. And you have to know about the weather there. They have a girl who does the weather on television every night. And at 12:05, this crazy-looking girl who's really endowed. And as I say, it's typical of this era. She's educated, knows about meteorology. And she kind of writes, you know, on a blackboard and all. And people really dig it. It's only 5 minutes. And she's been so successful with it that NBC is going to do a spectacular with her at the end of the year, kind of an anthology called The Best of the Weather, you know, all the good things. And she's right. And she's just going to, right? Exciting. Sonny, I wasn't going to talk about it. I want to say something about this press conference here. The president held a... No, I don't want to break context here. I didn't mean to... Free association can be abusive. The president said, doctor... So I know... You notice I use a lot of terms like free association and sibling rivalry and hostility and repression and catering to group needs and a lot of these terms, most of which I learned when I was at the Palo Alto Veterans Hospital many years ago. Very good. I really was. And... after the Korean War, right? So, which we will refer to for our purposes as World War 2.4, right? Anyway, we, you know, you have to have a handle on everything. So we were, I use a lot of these terms and on account of analysis, which I don't say too much about analysis because a lot of people are in it and a lot of people are out of it and a lot of people quit and a lot of people are afraid to go and everything. And you have to, the best thing about analysts is that if you don't make it with them, they will refer you to another analyst. And they call that, well, no other doctor will do that. Let's face it. You know, it's kind of, they call that rehabilitation referral, motivation therapy. And yes, I know, we call it fee splitting, don't we? Yes, right? Well, I know, but we're wrong. I'm very much in favor of that. Anyway, I didn't mean to tie, it did digress. So the president said at this press conference yesterday, he's talking, and he had a couple of, he kept saying, I don't know about that. He kind of, you know, it isn't he sidestepping, but he didn't want to become involved, you know, in the tawdry business, you know, of conflict and all. So he kept saying, well, I don't know about that, and I'm not sure, and a lot of that. So while he was checking with Haggerty, his press secretary and all, a lot of people, you know, got to yearning, like myself, I think, for the old days when people were definitive, you know, and they used to make sweeping generalizations. And of course, it's better now. Now we have advertising men who take random samples and then they make sweeping generalizations. But first, right? Got to take a random sample. So there hasn't been a good sweeping generalization since Senator McCarthy was around, because he used to say what he thought. And you might not have agreed with it, gang, but at least, right? He said what he thought. And he used to say things like, on television, the State Department is full of nothing but communists and homosexuals. Remember? And nobody had challenged it. That was the wild part. Except, right? I mean, except once, well, once in a while during the question period, someone would ask him if it's possible to belong to both groups because they had to meet. Right? Remember this? Yeah, all right, good. So, not yet. So, I need it later, insecurity in various areas. Anyway, so not to digress here, I'm going to say something about the Veterans Hospital on the next show. I talk about that later. And I'm also going to talk about sports cars in the next show. I have a few notes to add. I had a very bad experience with an Edsel. I'll have to tell you about. Have any of you driven the Edsel yet? Well, no one's driven the Edsel because no one owns an Edsel. But I mean, it's, you know, the accounting for this car is being handled by the Ford Foundation, I gather. So, have you ever seen anybody in one? Well, they're great cars, and they have, they're kind of, well, it's a problem of who the Edsel dealer is. This guy in Van Ness is a very weird guy, and he's kind of, he drives one. Of course, you know, dealers drive them. That doesn't mean an awful lot. And whenever he sees a crowd, he always parks it and gets out and looks at it admiringly. That's a form of, you know, salesmanship, and hits it on the hood, you know. So, you know, there, noble steed. Well done, right? That's what he's saying, in effect. So I don't think there's anything wrong with a little of that decorative talk from the old days. So anyway, I don't know what he did before he was an Edsel dealer, but I talked to him, and he was very evasive. And I kept saying to him, what did you do before you were an Edsel dealer? And he wouldn't look at me, you know? And he keeps saying, well, I was around. He knows a lot of that. So it haunted me for a while, and then I went back to see him, and I had one of those moments of illumination when I knew where I'd seen him before, and I hit him with it. It was kind of cruel, but I figure, you know, it's a moment of truth. And he really turned to water, you know? Didn't I order a Tucker from you about 3 years ago? No, that's good. Thank you. No, not really. All right, now, to continue with our theme tonight, what is our theme? Oh, eggheads in government. Well, I just want to make one point about this. You see, Governor Stevenson was called back into the government around Christmas. A lot of you know about that. And he was called back in and he worked at the State Department for 3 days. And that's to prove that the administration at least tried. You know, he just didn't work out. And he's in the government for 3 days. And he was supposed to go to NATO and talk to the French. And instead, the president went. And to talk to them. And kind of Stevenson was in the State Department building, which is the most modern building in Washington, and was done by Raymond Loewy Associates. And Raymond Loewy, as you know, has the Legion of Honor in his coat for designing the Coke bottle. That's what he got it for. That's kind of an honor. And and for his work on the 1954 Studebaker, he wears a mourning band, which is in keeping with the values. No? Anyway, I know, I really wonder about this, but it's all right. So they did this building, and he doesn't do it anyway. You know, he's just a guy, you know, he's kind of strong, he's an administrator. And he has this guy who works for him, who is a prominent architect from Southern California, upon whom the book The Fountainhead was based. And he actually did that. He actually went out to a project he had designed, kind of an aesthetic veterans housing project in the San Fernando Valley. And somebody got snuck in there at night, you know, put a lot of gingerbread on it and beaver board and Baroque and all. So then he got sore and actually blew it up. Neglecting to inform the tenants of his intention to preserve his material. So, writing. So anyhow, Anyway, this guy designed the building, and Stevenson was working in the State Department building across the hall from Dulles. This isn't generally known. Even my guys like Pearson and all, you never talk about this. And Stevenson was in there writing this speech, which the president had so much trouble with, as you recall. And remember, and everybody thought he was sick and everything, remember? And there's a lot of words like bifurcation and obfuscate and everything. So, you know, and a lot of things you don't need to get your message across. Just say what you think, you know? But, you know, Stevenson has always had this thing. So anyway, so... He went to Princeton, you know. He went to Princeton, where they don't have any fraternities there, I found out on this trip. They have eating clubs. So, well, that's all right. And the same people who couldn't can't, can they? That's right. Okay, good. So anyway, Stevenson was working up there writing these speeches for the president to take to NATO, and then somebody got the wild idea of sending Stevenson to Paris to talk to the French, and then all the editorials started hitting all the good papers, you know? And the one paper, of course, that really took up the cudgels, of course, this one, this or the Examiner, you don't want this. It depends on your point of view. If you're really conservative, and I want to define all these terms, see, about being conservatives and all, if you're really strong with the party, you should, I want to define this. Like, the president is a modern Republican, and somebody said that conservative Republicans don't believe that anything should be done for the first time. Do you remember that definition? And then the modern Republicans said it should be, but not now. You remember? There's that kind of art. So, remember? So, well, Stevenson, of course, believed, that, well, yeah, anyway, he wasn't that conservative. He didn't have that kind of thing going. And he and the president kind of saw eye to eye on an awful lot of things, except, for instance, the integration issue, which I'm going to talk about a little later, because I understand that the governor of Tennessee wants to meet now with the president and talk to him about integrating the Memphis schools. He doesn't think they're ready yet. So the president is going to meet him at the Burning Tree Club, and they're going to talk. And then, of course, Hubert Humphrey, who is one of the he's a far-out Democrat, started criticizing the president, which is easy to do, you know, if you're not wrapped up in this thing. And he said, if there was really a man in the White House, you know, he'd take a colored girl by the hand and lead her through that line of bigots into the high school, which is easy to say, you know, when you're not involved in this thing. But if you're in the administration, you got a lot of problems of policy. Like, right? Whether or not to use an overlapping grip, which is one of the cases. But no? All right. Anyway, we'll talk about it. So what are we talking... Oh, yes, I left Stevenson in the building. At any rate, the problem was... Whether or not to send him to Paris. So they didn't know what to do, whether or not to send him over. And then, as I say, if you're really a conservative, you wouldn't want to read these papers. You'd want the opinion of a real newspaper. Like, I guess a lot of you know at the St. Francis, you can get the Chicago Tribune every day, which is flown in for you, packed in ice. You can get it. And my landlady here in town gets it. She gets the Chicago Tribune, and she's extremely kind of, she does things like it belongs to the DAR and the Anti-UN League. She's in that. And she has a large American flag in front of the house all day. And a lot of people, not knowing the philosophy within, often stop and try to vote, which is a mistake. Don't make it. So anyway, this is weird. This paper, see, the Chicago Tribune pointed out in an excellent editorial attack upon Stevenson that he shouldn't go to NATO to talk to them. And they said they should send Nixon. And they felt the Vice President Nixon can talk to people. That was the thesis of it. And it pointed out, they had a pretty good case, too, because they pointed out that on his recent trip around the world, he was very big with people. They all dug him. And everywhere he'd go, you know, people would turn out for parades and say, remember this moment, Jimmy, to their children up on their shoulders. Even if they couldn't see it, they wanted the kids to have something to live with, you know. And they'd have kind of festivals and everything. And luau's and everything. So I'm going through various areas of the world, you understand. And then, anyway, Vice President Nixon was offered several countries of his own. That's what I was getting at. And he, right? But he didn't want to take them because he knew, you know, later he'd have to go on television and explain the presence. Right? So, anyway, so... This is great. So Stevenson, they point this out in the Tribune, and really well written. And then they point out that Stevenson, on the other hand, went around the world and couldn't communicate with anybody. So what do you want him, you know, for an ambassador for? Because he couldn't talk to people. And these are not people who are prejudiced against him. These are very backward peoples who just have sheer perception, it says. And see, and he, right? And he would go into, you know, you don't need sophistication if, you know, there's that old horse sense. And he'd go into these bucolic areas where people lived in trees and so forth, and he'd start to talk to them in the clearing there while he's protected by members of the tribe. Anyway, and he'd talk to them, and these people who are surely perceptive would say, I don't know what it is with this American, but I don't seem to feel any warmth when he talks to me. I don't know, he's scholarly, but there's a lack of contact. That's, you know, and he commented on the quick smile and all. And don't forget, you know, this is not prejudice, because these are people who are, you know, are barely sophisticated enough to, you know, to write their names in the dirt with a stick. You know, that's what they point out. If they were here, they could vote. So, no? All right. Something to think about. So anyway, Stevenson was wrapped up in the State Department building, and he's writing this speech, and the reason he quit the government, he wasn't fired, he quit, was because nobody talked to him. He's an intellectual, you know, and he's an egghead, but he's a guy. And, right? You like that? I got some human value since I left. I used to be a machine, but now I believe in these. So nobody talked to him. And, you know, they'd go to lunch, and they'd all go down the hall, you know, the president and the vice president and Sherman Adams and Ezra Benson and all of them, kind of making a flying wedge. And come to the end of the hall, almost looked like unity if you didn't. And then they coming down to the end, and the president would say, "Why don't we ask him to eat?" And he'd point to the window, and the attorney general would say, "Well, I'm against it, you know, because it's one thing to have him work for you, but you don't have to, you know." So... So, of course, Stevenson, you know, would, you know, tear himself away from these, you know, scholastic activities and look down at the car lot there. He had an unimpeded view, and he'd see them get into that bubble dome Lincoln they have there to avert suspicion of an alliance with that company. And see them take off in the Lincoln, you know, with the Secret Service guys riding on, holding their hats and all. And he knew that, you know, that they were going to eat, you know. And then he did a lot of things that the Democrats in the audience won't like. You've got to face reality. He manifested a kind of a juvenile attitude. And he said a lot of things. I know you don't see him this way, but he really did it. And he'd look at the car, and he'd do a lot of things which you and I would do, which is hard, you know, for if you have a hero image. But, you know, he'd say a lot of things like, well, you know, I didn't want to eat anyway, you know. Right? Which is weird, right? And sometimes that juvenile thing would manifest itself, and he'd open the window and yell a lot of things at the president when the car would go by, you know, like, "Big business," you know? Right? Exciting. You know, this is true. Well, it's hard to face. I wanted to ask if any of you saw Wide Wide World this afternoon, which is the cultural affair on NBC television. And you may have seen it in the afternoon with Dave Garraway sitting on a stool symbolizing man. And then, right? Peace without honor? Yes. So Dave Garraway. And then the world is in back of him, which is proper perspective at the National Broadcasting Company, if you've been there. And he's kind of a symbol there of heroism. Anyway, the program today had 60 cameras, roving crews. And they did a survey of American prisons, you know, what Americans do on Sunday in prison kind of show. So, you know, I think it's certainly been needed for a long time. So they went, if you saw this was the end, this is true. So they went to the Ohio State prison, and they had Warden Peterson there, who's kind of a free thinker, and he showed them how he had developed a circular cell block where prisoners are faced to look at each other. It's insane, it's kind of sadism. He had that, and then he developed the gas chamber, he said was developed there 21 years ago to do away with a lot of, you know, regressive kind of things like, you know, like electrocution, a lot of prison activities like that. And then he also developed solitary confinement. He said he started that himself, Peterson, and it was later copied by less creative people in his field, which is something you have to live with, you know, if you're a free-thinking kind of... So at any rate, so in the end, he was standing there with all his inmates around him, suspiciously close, I might add, and Garraway was pulling his camera back, and he said to him, he said, "Warden, what motivates a man to devote 40 years of his life to prison work?" And the warden, with characteristic modesty, said, "I guess I like people, Dave." I thought, did you see this? Right? Kind of gets you, doesn't it? And well, now, before we go, I did want to say a couple of words about the Beat Generation, if I can, because I really saw it up close. I was working in Greenwich Village, lucky me. And while I was down there, I was it was kind of exciting in New York City because the IRT stopped running. There was kind of a panic there, and people were learning to live off the land. You know how New Yorkers are. So we went. it was really a kick, though. So while I was in Greenwich Village, some of you read, a spy was arrested there named Colonel Rudolf Abel, who is the first Russian spy to be arrested in this country in 13 years. It was kind of, you know, a real morale builder for a lot of us. Because, you know, right? You know, and he was arrested by the field office of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, and they called in New York and called up Washington and said, "We found a Russian spy in the village." And you probably read about his trial in Life magazine. And they said, "We found this Russian spy." And, of course, the Washington people have a typical distrust of field offices. And they said, "Ah, come on now, you know, stop playing at cloak and dagger. You know, you mean, what'd you get? You know, what is he, a school teacher? You know, or are you sure he isn't a writer or something?" And they said, "No." "And is he addicted to folk music?" And all, they're having kind of a checklist. I said, "No, he's a spy, you know, we wouldn't kid you. You know, it doesn't happen this often, you know. And, you know, it only happens once." And the guys in Washington were saying, "How do I know it's real?" There was a lot of that. So the problem was how to evaluate this thing. See, because we hadn't had any spies for a long time. And the guys in Washington were justified in their cynicism, I think, because we hadn't had any spies for a long time. And the Russians, meanwhile, had all kinds of spies. Not real ones, but they're unscrupulous. And I have a lot of student friends who were in Europe, and the Russians would always arrest them. They'd always be around, you know, the Eastern Zone on Sunday with their rollies, you know. And the Russians would throw them in prison for the rest of their lives, you know. or the end of the Fulbright, which is the same thing in our group. I don't know about, right? It's a very dependent kind of. So when they are, so we had never had a spy, and we tried to do, you know, better in the Olympics and build a better car and a lot of things like that, but we never had a spy, and people began to get depressed for several years. And it got so bad, as you recall, for a while they had a committee to find spies. That was their job, and they used to travel around and try to find spies, and they were pretty good guys, but let's face it, you know, if there's none to be had, there's none to be had. So there was a kind of a retaliatory thing going on. And for a long time, you remember that there was a kind of a Cold War, the seesaw, and every time the Russians would put an American in jail, this committee would put an American in jail, but that didn't quite meet the need. Remember this? So then they got Colonel Abel, so a lot of us were happy, and then he was brought into federal court in Philadelphia and had all these people who lived around him in the village who had known him for 7 years. And they were all people, you know, government witnesses, and they're all people who, you know, read poetry in front of jazz groups, people like that, and wear duffel coats and sandals, and kind of real revolt people. And they had... you know, and people who paint with rollers and people who make jewelry and everything. So they were, they all came in and they said that they knew Abel for 7 years when he had moved on to McDougal Street in the village. They had come in with a welcome wagon, you know, to welcome him with, you know, hashish and long pipes and all the other value. Anyway, so they said the government prosecutor asked them if they knew he was a Russian spy because they're trying to build a conspiracy case. And these people all said, oh yeah, you know, quite openly, you know, when he moved in, we asked him what he did. And he said, you know, I'm a Russian spy, you know. And then all these artists would say, well, that's the village, you know, why judge it? Yeah, exciting. All right, now we have, now are there any groups which we have not offended in some small way? I've gone into every field except theism. I do that on the next show, and I'll tell you all about the Billy Graham rally in New York, which I went to in your interest, kind of a consumer's test. And I went to see him, and he's pretty wild, and he's got, I thought it quite significant that his annual report is in the paper for the 57 Crusade to save souls, and it didn't get into the religious section on Saturday or Sunday, but it's on the financial page, which I think is significant, right? Well, he did very well. There's nothing wrong with, you know, paying your way. So at any rate, that isn't what I meant. I thought I heard some bowling upstairs. So anyway, he does that all the time. You got the wrong connotation. I think too many of you are free associating. You know, that didn't mean, no, that's not that. You know, that's Graham does that all the time. He's always reading and looking up, you know, which even people in the field will admit is an assumption. We don't know. I mean, we think, right? He does that, and he always says to his audiences, do you believe? That's his big cheerleading thing. And the audiences always say, you know, they're very vociferous. They're kind of a cross between the bonus march and, you know, jazz at the Philharmonic. Anyway, it's known everywhere. And they always say, you know, he always says to them, do you believe? And the audience always lays it on him, you know, like, you know it, you know. Like, oh, sure. And then, so, and then they always, you know, and then a couple of minutes later, he'll be in Original Sin or something. All of a sudden, he'll stop, you know, like they never said it. And he'll say, do you believe? And then they lay it on him again. And then a couple of minutes later, he'll do it again. He does this all the time, you know. So he obviously is insecure in these areas. I mean, there's no other, right? No. Yes. Wonderful. So, yeah, thank you. So I'll have more to say about him later. I don't want to give all this away, but it's really weird. It was a very weird rally, and at the rally, you read about this kook who went out, this kind of weird guy, went out and started collecting money with the others. He's not really an usher. And, you know, he's putting money in the bag and everything, and nobody knew because the sun was in back of him forming a nimbus. You know, it's just suggestive. Right? So, hey, you're very well schooled in this area. So I was, you know, and I would, meanwhile, was taking pictures of Graham like crazy because I wanted to show something to the folks back home. And then later on, I developed the role and it was blank, which is really weird, but I don't. Anyway, so then this guy collected all the bread and he said, collected all the money, and he started to split with the money, and these two policemen caught him at the gate at the rally, and they brought him to Billy Graham's feet for salvation. And he said, what are you doing with the money? And he said, I took the money in an effort to get closer to God by eliminating the middleman, of course. So, thank you. Now, we'll see. We'll close this off now, cut the tape, and say goodnight, and we'll see you in about an hour. Thank you very much.